Welcome, everybody, to another season of Tyrannus. Another great Bible study with Dr. Tom McCall, beautiful music with Mr. Doolin, with Bob Doolin, and we really are glad to have you with us. And know that many of you from all over the world are now in the chat room, and we want to say hi to you, some old friends, some new friends. My name is Grady Baskin. I'm a media director for the School of Tyrannus, and as many of you know, we had a little difficulty coming up this year. Lost a server, lost all our servers last Wednesday, and it has been an absolute nightmare getting back up. But by the grace of God and the prayers of all of you folks, we have been able to get up. We finished about 1 o'clock last night. We were broadcasting to the world, so praise the Lord. Want to say a special thanks to our team, Bob Bryant, Robbie Bryant, and they're both on the West Coast. Jim Leidner, who worked with me until 1 o'clock last night, I'm not sure where Jim is. I think he's either on the East Coast or he's in heaven. Hard to confuse those two. Anyway, the thing is that Jim finally found some code that had been transposed, so we were able to get up on both high bandwidth and low bandwidth. And as those of you who have been with us for several years know that it's a tradition with us to, and we broadcast from Grace High School, the media center out here, and we've had a tremendous, as always, tremendous blessing. And that blessing is Grace Church and Grace School. And I want to thank a few people in particular who, without their efforts, this broadcast and this Bible study would not be possible. And I want to say a particular thanks to Jay Ferguson, who's the headmaster out here at Grace School. Wanda Schaefer is the principal, and the assistant principal is Galen Taylor. Now, they're the administration, but I'll tell you who I work with is the janitorial crew out here. They're the people that you really want to get something done, and you really know what you need to come in the middle of the night out here. They're the people that work all night. They're the people who just go out of their way, as I think some of you saw who came in early tonight, what they do for us here. And I want to thank in particular Ron Russell, my buddy Mike Duggar, who he ought to be on staff at School of Tyrannus instead of Grace. I may get in trouble saying that. And his assistant Stephen and assistants Stephen and Sandra, and a new guy this year that I can't call his name, and I should, but he is a tremendous fellow. He was out here with us last night too. I'll get his name, and we'll put that up on the website as some kind of substitute for my poor memory. I want to thank Greg Brandenburg out here at Grace School. He initially, 5 years ago, I guess, when we first started trying to think about broadcasting, Greg got us up, actually. And he wasn't around last night, though. Greg, where were you, buddy, when we needed you? But Greg is a tremendous asset to us. And also, Danita Sailors, who has now left Grace. She has gone to Garland, she and her husband. She's now with my buddy Clint Taylor over at the First Baptist Church in Garland. For those of you watching throughout the world, Garland is a suburb, a rather large suburb of Dallas. So Clint and Allison Taylor are now taking care of Danita Taylor and her husband. And there is a new lady here that I have not yet met who is our media director of the Media Center out here, and I'm looking forward to meeting her, and I'll put her name up on the website also, because we owe these people a tremendous debt of gratitude. Thank you all so much. Welcome to the School of Tyrannus and Study of Acts. I think I'd like to introduce now somebody you all know, and that's Bob Doolin. And Bob is going to introduce Tom. Good to see you.
Well, good evening from the School of Tyrannus, broadcasting from the Media Center at Grace High School in Tyler, Texas. We're glad to be back with you for a new season, fall semester, where Dr. Tom McCall will be teaching on the Book of Acts. And we'll start with that in just a minute. First, a little music. Thank you.
just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't worry o'er the future, for I know what Jesus said. And today I'll walk beside Him, for He knows what is ahead. Many things about tomorrow I don't seem to understand, but I know who's tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Every step is getting brighter as the golden stairs I climb. Every burden's getting lighter, every cloud is silver lined. There the sun is always shining, there no tear will dim the eye. At the ending of the rainbow, where the mountain meets the sky, many things about tomorrow I don't see.
Things about tomorrow I don't pretend to understand, but we know who's in control, don't we?
Yeah.
Amen. Well, by popular request, Tom is going to begin these sessions with an update on the situation in Israel.
Yeah.
And then he will start us on our study of the book of Acts. I don't know about you, but I'm really looking forward to this. So, Dr. Tom, will you come?
Well, welcome to the School of Tyrannus and the study of the Book of Acts. And study of the Word of God. We are going to have 10 lessons 10 class times this semester, and we're going to cover the first half of the book of Acts, the Lord willing, during this semester. And the second half, again, the Lord willing, in the spring semester. But as Bob said, and we appreciate that good music, as Bob said, we are going to have a time of consideration of biblical prophecy and what's happening in Israel of prophetic significance. Of course, we've had quite a summer when once again the enemies of Israel unleashed their rockets and tried to destroy Israel. We had the president of Iran, ancient Persia, voicing threatenings that Israel is supposed to be wiped off the face of the earth, and that he'd like to have a hand in doing that. One Israeli responded to that saying, that's surprising. I didn't know that Iran had Israel on the map. They want to remove what's ever there. Well, I've got news for President A. I'm not going to try to pronounce his name. The Lord is not going to allow Israel to be wiped off the map. In fact, Israel is going to become the head of the nations and no longer the tail. Right now, I guess you could say it's still the tail of the nations. But the Lord is going to address that problem and correct it. Just a few observations about where do we go from here to the tribulation. I'm assuming that you have been schooled, and I know many of you have, and I assume all of you have, in the rudiments of biblical prophecy, and that you understand that in the end times there's going to be the rapture of the church and the tribulation, 7 years of tribulation, the 70th week of Daniel, which will be featuring the Antichrist, and is going to end in the War of Armageddon and the second coming of Christ. We won't go into detail about those things, but those are the rudiments. And then when Christ returns to the earth, as he left it, he will establish his kingdom upon the earth and will be King of Kings and Lord of Lords for 1,000 years. And we will reign with him. The church will reign with him. The Old Testament saints will reign with him. The tribulation saints will reign with him. And there will be a marvelous reign of the Lord Jesus Christ. And this time not as the lamb that came to suffer, but as the lion who comes to rule. And he will reign for 1,000 years. Now, having said that, and those are sort of the rudiments that we learn very early, or should learn very early in our Christian experience. We've done some study about what about from here to the tribulation. Does the Scripture say anything about events between now and the tribulation? I believe there are some indications. Now, the order of these events may not be 100% clear, but we're going to suggest a scenario of how these things might come out. We know all of these things will come about. What is a little uncertain is the order in which they come about. But the first would be the rapture of the church. And his coming is imminent for us. He could come at any moment. He could come tonight. Would you like that?
Amen. Yeah.
Just to go right up here from the school of Tyrannus right up to meet the Lord in the air. That would be a marvelous, wonderful thing. What are we going to do with the book of Acts then? I guess we'll have to study it up there. Or at any rate, we will. It would be a marvelous thing if the Lord were to come tonight. But he may not come tonight. He may wait till tomorrow. Or Friday. people are kind of wondering about Friday. We don't set dates around here. The Lord's told us not to, but you know, the rapture is going to be the fulfillment of the Feast of Trumpets. And the trumpet's going to sound, and we're going to be gathered to that great convocation in the sky. And Friday is Rosh Hashanah, which is the Feast of Trumpets, which is the next feast to be fulfilled. And a lot of people are wondering whether Friday the Lord might surprise us and take us home to be with Himself. Well, we don't know exactly when the Lord is coming, but we know His coming is imminent, and He might come at any moment. But what about after that? Well, there is a prophecy in Isaiah 17 that has not been given much attention. Isaiah 17:1, that describes the event that Damascus, have you heard of Damascus? Damascus, the capital of Syria, one of the countries adjoining Israel, is going to be destroyed and is going to become as a ruined heap. A ruined heap. Well, question is, has that ever happened before? Did that happen in the Assyrian invasion or the Babylonian invasion or any time in past history? People scratch their heads and they can't figure out any time when that's been done. It's never been done. So it's going to happen. The Lord says it's going to happen. Possibly it's an end time prophecy, and it's something that's going to happen between the rapture and the tribulation. So if that were to happen, and can you imagine anything happening whereby Israel might unleash its fury against Damascus and level it? If Damascus and Syria in this last war here this summer was threatening to invade Israel, and they've made a treaty, Syria has made a treaty with Iran and Russia, imagine that. There is some intelligence communications about they're setting up missiles on the mountains of Syria facing toward Israel and the West and Europe. Well, if that were to happen, I can well imagine Israel responding. And it wouldn't be a pretty sight. And it's possible that that might be the occasion for the destruction of Damascus. Then what would Iran do if Damascus was leveled? Well, they've got a treaty, and Russia has a treaty with them. That might be the occasion for the Gog and Magog War, described in Ezekiel 38 and 39. And not only Russia and Persia, but also Libya and Sudan and Ethiopia. Those countries are mentioned in Ezekiel 38 and 39. And some others in Eastern Europe and so forth. Well, selected nations coming against Israel. Can you imagine the nations coming against Israel? Is that a possibility in our world? Well, it's happened. It's not only a possibility, it's something that happened in recent memory, even this year. And all the nations of the world are convulsed about what to do about Lebanon now, and the Hezbollah, and Iran, and Syria, and all the rest of them now. So we're right in the thick of this. 150 years ago, who would have thought such a thing would come to pass? Except people who believe the Bible. And yet now we're living through it. These are remarkable days. We're in the end times. And if there was a Gog and Magog war and the invading nations were destroyed, then, as is indicated, then that might well set the stage for the rise of the Antichrist, who will make a treaty with Israel for 7 years, and that begins the tribulation. So I don't know if things will happen exactly in that order, or if that's exactly the way that it will come to pass, but we know that these things must happen, and that is a suggested scenario of how they might indeed come to pass. I'm not a prophet, nor the son of a prophet. I'm not even a non-profit prophet. But I seek to study the prophets and understand what they say and endeavor to interpret them as best we can. Okay, well, that's a little bit about prophecy and Israel. And we're going to try to get that outline up on our website or on a link for you, and you can download it maybe between now and next week. Okay, the book of Acts, the transitional book, the transitional book from the dispensation of the law to the dispensation of grace. And it is a remarkable book. And you may say, well, I've studied Acts before, and I think I've learned about all I need to know about Acts. Well, I hope as we go through this, it will be a real eye-opening experience for you and for all of us as we open the Word of God and seek to understand exactly what was going on as the disciples, the apostles, and the early believers went through this experience of transition. Beginning with verse 1 of chapter 1. The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach. What former account? Well, the book of Luke. Both are addressed to Theophilus. Well, who in the world is Theophilus? Where did he come? Now, he's not one of the disciples. Where did he come into the thing? There's a lot of speculation about Theophilus. By the way, his name means lover of God. But one idea that I think makes a lot of sense is that Theophilus was the publisher of the book of Luke. Why, did they have publishers back then? They didn't even have printing presses back then. How could they have publishers? We have learned that in the first century, there were reproducers of written material. And they had factories, as it were, and scriptoriums. And people would be assigned to copy a book. Now, this was true certainly of the scriptures, and the scriptures were copied, but also every publication that was made. And the scribes would copy the books so that it could go out to the public. You know, in recent times, we've had a similar situation in Russia. You remember at the end of the Cold War, before the end of the Cold War, there was a tremendous amount of literature going out among the people behind the Iron Curtain. Well, how did they do that? They didn't have the printing presses. They didn't have the equipment. And so they copied the books and got them out. What was it called? Samizdat or something like that? Well, that was the situation in the first century. And thousands upon thousands upon thousands of copies of a book could be distributed in the first century. And it's possible that Theophilus was a publisher of the books. And who is I here? Well, this is anonymous, but scholars throughout history have unanimously agreed that it was Luke, Dr. Luke, the beloved physician, the continuing a companion of the Apostle Paul. Now then, we ask the question, well, who was Luke? And almost Without exception, every commentary you will pick up about Luke and Acts will say that Luke was a Gentile. And we ask the question, was Dr. Luke a Gentile? Now, what are the reasons they give for Luke being a Gentile? Well, he was a doctor, and Jews didn't have any doctors, they said. And therefore, he was had to be a Greek. There were only three medical schools in the world at the time, and they were all Greek schools around the world, and had to be a Gentile. Another reason given is he is not listed with the Jewish Christians in Colossians, although Luke is mentioned separately. And based on that rather flimsy evidence, I would suggest, they claim that Luke was a Gentile. Well, what difference does it make? Well, first of all, is it true? That's the main question. But whoever wrote Luke and Acts wrote more pages of the New Testament than any other person. There are more pages written by Luke than by Paul, by John, any of the other writers of the New Testament. So it's a pretty important role that Luke has. Well, there are several reasons why I believe that Luke was a Jew. I've written an article on this subject. Maybe I can post that article for you on the internet, on our website. But among them are all the scriptures were written by Jews. Paul says that it was given unto Israel to have the oracles of God in Romans 3. That is their special responsibility, to have the written oracles of God. And if Luke is the only exception, it's a mighty big exception. And it should be proven. I think the burden of proof rests on those who believe that Luke was a Gentile. But there are other things. He has a very in-depth knowledge of the priesthood and the temple. He's the one that describes Zechariah and his receiving the message from the angel Gabriel in the temple as he was doing his particular chore, assigned chore, in the temple. And he describes it in minute detail. Why does Luke, the so-called Gentile, have this information and not the others? He has a lot of Hebraisms in his book. He mentions about going up to Jerusalem, going down from Jerusalem. Those are Hebraisms. The Gentile would say, well, we're going to go over to Jerusalem or go to Jerusalem. But the Jews say that we go up to Jerusalem. Aliyah, we go up. Other reasons, I won't go into all of them. One of them is that he, of all of them, all the gospel writers, all four of them, is the only one that describes the events surrounding the virgin birth of Jesus. And especially those things pertaining to Mary. It's almost as though Luke had become for a period of time the attending physician of Mary, the mother of Jesus. And he mentions that Mary hid in her heart all of these things. Hid in her heart. In other words, she wasn't going around blabbing these things to everybody, all comers. But she did to Luke. How did Luke get into this inner circle of the Jerusalem church with Mary, so that she would be able to meet him and have confidence in him and vice versa? And she gave him these intimate details that nobody else received. Well, I believe he was Jewish. He was a Jewish believer. He accompanied Paul. And when Paul was imprisoned in Caesarea, that he had opportunity to go to Jerusalem and visit with Mary and get these facts. Well, another reason is when Paul was arrested, Luke was with Paul in Jerusalem, in the temple. And the argument and the cry was from the people that Paul had brought Trophimus the Ephesian into the temple, a Gentile. Of course, he hadn't. He'd been in Jerusalem with Paul, but not in the temple. But Luke was there. Why didn't they cry out about Luke being there with Paul in the temple if he was a Gentile? No, I believe he was a Jew. Okay. Verse 2, until the day when he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen. So Jesus was with his disciples until the day he was taken up. Off and on, he made appearances to them in his resurrection glory. Verse 3, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. He showed himself alive, resurrected. He was not an apparition. He was not a ghost. He was not a figment of their imagination. He showed with many infallible proofs, things that a doctor would look for. Is he real? Can you touch him? Can you see him? Can he speak? Can he eat? Is he human? All of these questions were asked and answered by the presence of Jesus during those 40 days. And he taught them. Verse 4, and being assembled together, and by the way, this is, if you're looking at your handout, and those of you who are on on the website, on the web students, you can get these handouts, and they're available. They were available this week through our newsletter, and in future time will be available through linkages, and we'll try to have this week's available for you during this coming week. And you can turn to these pages. This is the most ancient papyrus of the book of Acts, and it goes way back to the second century. And this is the map of Judea during the first century. And this is a map of Jerusalem. If you go on down your page, if you're at home, and you see where the house of the Last Supper was, in the sort of the lower left-hand corner. And they went out probably through this gate at the very bottom of the map and over to Gethsemane. But now we are talking up here about the Mount of Olives, up on sort of the crest of the Mount of Olives on the east side of Jerusalem, looking over the Temple Mount. Now, this is what the old city of Jerusalem looked like in New Testament times. This is a model. And this is what it looked like from the Temple Mount. And this is another shot from the Temple Mount. A lot of graves there. Those are graves there. And now this is a shot from the Mount of Olives toward the Temple Mount, and you can see the Dome of the Rock there where the temple used to stand, and you can see in behind the city of Jerusalem, the new city of Jerusalem. And, of course, this is what they saw. They saw the great temple there, the Herodian temple. Now, this is the Church of the Ascension on the Mount of Olives. But it's been taken over by the Muslims and has been made into a mosque. And when it was a church, it didn't have a dome on it. It was open to the skies, you know, symbolic of the Ascension. But the Muslims put a dome on it. But at any rate, that is the traditional site of the Ascension of our Lord. Verse 4, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem. Not yet. But to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. By the way, how many days did they have to wait? We know exactly, because he departed on the 40th day, and the Feast of Pentecost was when the Holy Spirit came, and that was on the 50th day after the Feast of First Fruits, which was the day of resurrection. So we know they waited 10 days. That was the length of their wait. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Well, you know, there are Bible students, interpreters, teachers, who say, what a stupid question to ask. And the way they interpret this thing is that the Lord responded to them, have I been with you these 3 years and you haven't learned a thing? What's the matter with you guys? Don't you know there's not going to be a kingdom restored to Israel? That's the implication that they get out of this. But that's not what the Scripture says. This was a very logical question for them to ask. What had he been teaching them about, by the way, during these 40 days? The kingdom of God in verse 3. And it all the way through the Old Testament and all the way through the Gospels, the Lord had been teaching them about the coming kingdom and that there would be a kingdom restored to Israel. And that during that time, the restoration, he called it, the apostles would be ruling over Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel, and each one of the apostles would have a throne. And he kept teaching, as well as the Old Testament, about the coming kingdom of the Lord on the earth, when the Messiah would reign over the earth. Now, it was believed, because the prophet Zechariah prophesied it, that the feet of the Messiah would stand where when he came to do this? On the Mount of Olives. His feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives. Zechariah 14:4. So, we have Jesus with his disciples right on the Mount of Olives. And it is well to be understood that they thought, maybe he's going to do this right now. Wilt thou now at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Is this it? How excited they must have been. Jesus said, it's not for you to know the times or seasons which the Father has put into his own authority. This is not a denial of the coming of the kingdom. This is not a denial of the restoration of the kingdom to Israel. This is a warning that they don't know the times and the seasons when these things are going to come about. It hasn't been revealed. In the meantime, they have a job to do. Verse 8. but you shall receive power, dynamite. You shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. Wow, the end of the earth. How far is that? Does that include Texas?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
A little past
noonday. Yeah. So the gospel has gone throughout the world, and even come to Texas. Now it's going back from Texas, I guess, to all over the world, wherever our web students are, and we're grateful for that. So that was our commission. The Lord has, the Father has the times and seasons in His own hand. He will reveal them when He gets ready. He will restore the kingdom to Israel in His time. In the meantime, He's got a job to do, to be witnesses to me throughout the world. Now, when He had spoken these things while they watched, He was taken up, and a cloud received Him out of their sight. Can you imagine that? Here He was talking with them, been with them for 40 days. Of course, before that, been with them for 3 years. Now He was in His glorified body. He'd been with them 40 days, and He was talking with them, teaching them, giving them this great commission. And all of a sudden, He's gone up in a cloud. Disappeared. Ascended. They're looking. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as He went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, who also said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw Him go up into heaven." What are you doing standing up, looking up? He's gone. He's gone. But He's coming back. But you don't need to be staring up there. You've got a job to do. So they did the job. Verse 12. Then they returned to Jerusalem from a mountain called Olivet, which is near Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. This is where we learned that that's where they were. On the hill, the mountain of Olivet, on the east side of Jerusalem. And when they had entered, they went up into the upper room where they were staying. Peter, James, John, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas the son of James. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary the mother of Jesus and with His brothers. That was quite a retinue. We learned later that there was some 120 involved here. And most of them had come down with Jesus from Galilee. Imagine that crowd of pilgrims coming together. And here they were, gathered together in the upper room. Now, there is some discussion about where the upper room is. This map shows the room of the Last Supper being in this general area of Mount Zion, which is outside of the current wall of Jerusalem on the southeast side. But in the ancient times, it was within the wall. And this shows some of the things that are in that area, including the Church of the Door Mission and the upper room down here in the lower corner, the lower central of that page. The upper room building is this building here on the west side, on the left side of that picture, where the Church of Dormition is in the background. This is the inside of the traditional upper room. It is on the second floor, as you might well imagine. And you can see the architecture is Gothic. And you can see that it is really crusader. This architecture was done by the Crusaders when they came in around 1100 A.D. But it seems to be attached to the same location as the original upper room. There's a pretty strong tradition of that. This is a jar that was found in the foundations area by archaeologists around the upper room, only down in the ground. And it has the symbol of the menorah, the Star of David, and the fish, which became one of the early symbols, maybe the earliest symbol, of the Jews who believed in Jesus. It is a remarkable symbol indeed, and it's a beautiful thing, and it was found right in this area. So there's pretty strong archaeological evidence that the first church in Jerusalem was at this very site, around the upper room. Well, verse 15, and in those days Peter stood up in the midst of the disciples. Altogether the number of names was about 120, and said, men and brethren, this scripture had to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke before by the mouth of David concerning Judas, who became a guide to those who arrested Jesus. That was his function. For he was numbered with us and obtained a part in this ministry. Now this man purchased a field with the wages of iniquity, and falling headlong, he burst open in the middle, and all his entrails gushed out. How's that for a nice dinner verse? Yes, that's a brutal description of the death of Judas. And it became known to all those dwelling in Jerusalem, so that that field is called in their own language Akel Dama, that is, field of blood. For it is written in the book of Psalms, let his dwelling place be desolate, and let no one live in it, and let another take his office. Therefore, of these men who have accompanied us all the time that the Lord Jesus went in and out among us, beginning from the baptism of John to that day when he was taken up from us, one of these must become a witness with us of his resurrection. And they proposed too, Joseph called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And they prayed and said, you, O Lord, who know the hearts of us all, show which of these two you have chosen to take part in this ministry and apostleship, from which Judas by transgression fell, that he might go to his own place. And they cast their lots, and the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Well, here's a slide about the hanging of Judas. Another one about his hanging. The field of blood is in the valley of Gehenna, or the valley of Hinnom, on the southwestern side of the city of Jerusalem, and it's still there today. You can go there today and see the field of blood, Akel Dama. Then the disciples decided that they had to choose a replacement for Judas, let another take his place. And so they cast lots. Now, there's been some discussion about what these lots looked at and how did they do it. Well, these are some suggestions about what they look like. And so they had little shards. And then this is Haman casting lots in the book of Esther. This is another way, a gaming board, where lots might have been used. And this is an Orthodox icon of choosing of Matthias with those bones there on the table. So, we have the choosing of Matthias. Was this scriptural? Was Matthias, did he become one of the 12 apostles? There are some say, well, this was just a human act, and that the Lord replaced Judas with Paul, the apostle. That's a debate that goes on among interpreters. But at any rate, they felt they had to replace Judas, and they chose him by lot with prayer. Okay, this is a good place to break. And when we come back, we'll jump into chapter 2, the coming of the Holy Spirit.
Tommy, you want to tell them what they have for halftime?
And what do we have?
Dr. Andy Woods.
Dr. Andy Woods on what subject? About legal matters?
Yeah.
He's a lawyer preacher, lawyer theologian. So this is a very interesting interview for our web students. And on the other side of the interview will be our study of Acts 2. And those of us here will have a little break for refreshment. Welcome back to the School of Tyrannus. We've enjoyed our time of fellowship and refreshments in our local class, and we welcome our web students back from that very interesting interview with Dr. Andy Woods. We hope you appreciated that. And we are continuing in our study of the Book of Acts to chapter 2. Before we do that, as you know, this class comes to you free of charge. Freely we have received, freely we give. And but we do receive an offering for the Lord and for this ministry during the class. And Dewey Rice here has our bag, and he will start passing it around. Before he does that, let's have a time of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we dedicate ourselves first to you and then all that we have, because we know that we are completely owned by you. We have been purchased with a price. Everything we are and that we have belongs to you. And we joyously and give to you that which you have given to us. And that the Word of God might be proclaimed, that the gospel of Christ might be spread abroad throughout the world, continually, through this ministry and through all those that are committed to the gospel of Christ and the Word of God. All this we ask in the name which is above all names, the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Going on into the second chapter, we have when the day of Pentecost had fully come. They were all with one accord in one place. Now that statement there, when the day of Pentecost had fully come, is interesting. You don't find that about any other day that I know of in the Scriptures. And it's possible a good translation of that was when the day of Pentecost was fulfilled. That is, we know that each of the feasts that the Lord gave to Israel through Moses was a prophetic plan of the first and second comings of Christ. The Passover described the death of Christ, the Lamb of God. Unleavened bread described the burial of the unleavened bread of the body of Jesus into the ground. The Feast of First Fruits described the resurrection of the Messiah, and it occurred on the very day of the Feast of First Fruits. Then the next event was 50 days later on the Feast of Pentecost, and the fulfillment of the Feast of Pentecost was the coming of the Holy Spirit and the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of the believers and the baptizing of the believers in Christ into the body of Christ. Well, So it fully came. It was fulfilled. And they were all with one accord in one place. Which place? And that is where a little bit of the mystery is. And there's two main viewpoints on this. The traditional view is that the events of Pentecost occurred in the upper room, or near the upper room, or at the upper room. The other viewpoint is they occurred in the temple, on the Solomon's porch. Well, we're going to look at those views. Here is the Solomon's porch in our view here on our handout. This is another view of Solomon's porch from the south side. This is that famous mural painted by Torger Thompson that was in the Biblical Arts Center in Dallas until it was destroyed by fire. This earlier this year, wasn't it? Yes. And a sad event. My understanding is they were hoping to restore everything, but I haven't heard anything much about that since then. But it was a stunning painting, and it envisioned the fulfillment occurring on the Solomon's porch, on the temple platform, and you can see the pillars there, and Peter, and this broad area there. I had met Torger Thompson. In fact, I was involved with him at the time that he was painting this. So, this is very touching to me and very important. I must say, though, that I have come more to the viewpoint that the traditional view is accurate. And as we go through this, I'll try to point out some of the reasons why. That is, that it did occur at or around the upper room. And suddenly, there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Now this is another clue, I think, about where it was located. People didn't really sit in the temple precinct. There were no chairs. The priest couldn't sit in the temple. Now, what was available on Solomon's porch, we don't know, but we don't think that there were any chairs or really places to sit there. And this describes them that they were all, more or less, all sitting down when this happened, which suggests that the upper room might have been the location. But look what happened. A sound from heaven as a rushing, mighty wind. And, of course, the word for the Holy Spirit is pneuma. Pneuma means spirit, but it also means wind. And so whenever the wind is described, it's pneuma. Air is pneuma. You've got pneumatic tires. And the Holy Spirit is pneuma, hagia, spirit holy. But here it's just, the sound was a tremendous wind, like a tornado. And everybody who's lived through a tornado, and I don't relish the thought of doing that, but everybody who lives through a tornado says it sounds like a tremendous train coming down the track and running over you. It's just a tremendous, mighty sound. Verse 3 is even more surprising. And there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. Now, apparently there were 120 of them gathered in this one place. They were sitting down, and when the wind came, this fire came upon them. like tongues of flame, setting down on each one of them. That must have been a remarkable experience. Think of that. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. These flaming tongues had quite an effect on these individuals. They began to speak in foreign languages. Now, one thing about this experience in Acts 2 is that nobody went away from this experience saying, I didn't understand what was going on. I couldn't understand a word that was said. Everybody left this experience saying, I understood exactly what was said. In fact, I understood everything in my own native tongue. What an astonishing thing. Verse 5 says that they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. Why?
It was a feast.
It was a feast of Pentecost. Probably the most attended feast of all three of the major feasts of Israel. And the reason I say that is because the weather was better. It was usually in May and June, and travel from all over the world was a much easier matter in those months than in early spring or in the fall and so forth. At any rate, it was a highly attended feast. You say, well, how many people would that be? Well, Josephus tells us that the Passover was well attended. And Jerusalem's normal population of 300,000, which made it one of the great cities of ancient times, about the same size as Rome, if you could believe it. But at Passover, the city of Jerusalem was swollen with the tourists from all over the world to over 2.5 million. Almost 10 times the size of normal. And if Pentecost was better attended than Passover, there must have been that many there then, or more. And they were from everywhere. No wonder Rome was jealous of Jerusalem. People came from all over the Roman Empire and beyond the Roman Empire to Jerusalem to worship Yahweh, the Lord God. And when this sound occurred, verse 6, the multitude came together and were confused because everyone heard them speak in his own language. Everybody understood exactly what was being said. But they didn't understand how these Galileans knew how to speak in their language. Then they were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, look, are not all these who speak Galileans? We're down how to speak all these languages. And how is it that we hear each in our own language in which we were born? Parthians and Medes and Elamites, those dwelling in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya adjoining Cyrene. Visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes. Yes?
From Barbara Lewis.
Hi, Barbara.
Don't the Jews believe that when God speaks, everyone can understand in their own language?
The question is, don't the Jews believe that when God speaks, everyone understands in his own language? Well, he hasn't spoken to many people in their own language. Personally, yes. And that would be, and God certainly knows all the languages. When he spoke to Moses, I would imagine he spoke in Hebrew. But here, he uses the people, the disciples, 120 of them, to speak to their own languages. And in that sense, God spoke in everybody's language. And so, Barbara, you're right. He used people to do it. And people who didn't know any languages. What a remarkable thing. Now, so why did the Lord make these people wait 10 more days after the ascension until the day of Pentecost to send the Spirit? It was precisely for this reason. This was going to be the explosion point, Jerusalem, whereby the gospel would go out to the ends of the earth. So he brings all these people to Jerusalem to hear the gospel in their own language so that they can go back home with the good news. What an advertising deal.
And he planned this how far in advance?
How far in advance did he plan it? Surely, by the time he gave the feast to Moses, and my suspicion is that he planned it from eternity past. But this was the day. It was fully come. It was fulfilled. And everybody heard the gospel in his own language. And there were both Jews and proselytes. Mostly Jews, but there were some proselytes. A proselyte was a Gentile who had converted to Judaism. He'd been circumcised, gone through the whole deal, and was a bona fide Jew, for all intents and purposes. Then 11, Cretans and Arabs, who believed in Yahweh. And we're there in Jerusalem. We hear them speaking in our own tongues the wonderful works of God. So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, whatever could this mean? Not everybody. There were some mockers in the group. And they said, oh, others mocking said, they are full of new wine. They're just a bunch of drunkards. Sure, a bunch of drunkards who learned to speak 30 different languages or more. How is this? So, what's the answer to this? But Peter, standing up with the 11, raised his voice and said to them, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and heed my words. This is Peter. Peter, who not too long before said, I don't know this man. I've never met him. I'm not one of them. Something has happened to Peter. First of all, Jesus has risen from the dead, and he's seen the risen Jesus. Secondly, he's been empowered by the Holy Spirit. Now he goes into an explanation, verse 15, for these are not drunk as you suppose, since it's only the third hour of the day. Now, the Roman days started at 6 o'clock in the morning. So the third hour of the day was 9 o'clock in the morning. And his argument was, they can't be drunk, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. Who gets drunk at 9 o'clock in the morning? Well, that was his answer to that. But this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. Now notice, doesn't have the scroll in front of him. He doesn't reach down and pick up Joel and start reading from it. He starts quoting verse after verse after verse from Joel. From memory. And he was a fisherman from Galilee. I tell you, some people's idea of ancient Israel is that it was a backwater place of illiterate, uneducated people. in the backwaters of the Roman Empire. But these people, even up in Galilee, were educated, were literate, and they certainly knew the scriptures. And they had committed them to memory. And here Peter, all of a sudden he just grabs this out of the air, this prophecy from Joel. He says, whoa! I read something about this in Joel. And this is it. This is what Joel was speaking about. And it shall come to pass in the last day, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my men servants and on my maid servants I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath, blood and fire, vapor and smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. And it shall come to pass that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But he's saying, you see, Joel talked about this, that the Spirit of God would come, and that people would be filled with by the Spirit of God and would be making utterance of the Word of God. And all this will happen before the wonders in heaven and the blood, the moon turning into blood, before the coming of the great and awesome day of the Lord. Well, has all that come about even now? No. So he moves from an experience that is like the end times experience, and he says all of this has to happen before the awesome, the great and awesome day of the Lord, which I take is equivalent to the great tribulation. But whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, what did Peter know? He knew that the Messiah had come. He knew that the Messiah had died for the sins of Israel and for the world. He knew that the Lord was coming back. Did he know when the Lord was coming back? No. As far as he was concerned, these events to come could be imminent. Could be right around the corner. And he was warning them and preparing them for the second coming of the Messiah. He continues on. Men of Israel, hear these words. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him in your midst, as you yourselves also know. Jesus didn't operate in a corner. He was operating in full view of Israel, and tremendous things were happening. Miracles were happening. Lame people were made to rise up. Blind people were made to see. Deaf people were made to hear. They knew about it. They had heard about it. And this generation that he's talking to, him being delivered by the, in verse 23, delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God. All these things that happened to Jesus, as bad and as awful as they were all predetermined by the all-knowing, all-seeing God who's created heaven and earth. You know, there's some people in seminaries today who are teaching the open Open theology. Open theology. What does that mean? Well, it means that God doesn't know what's going to happen. He's waiting around to find out what we're going to do, and then He's going to respond. That is not the God of the Bible. The God of the Bible is all-knowing, all-understanding, all-seeing, all-wise. And nothing that happened to Jesus, for instance, surprised Him. It was all in accordance with His plan that He would be the sacrifice for the sins of the world. Nevertheless, there is human responsibility. Him being delivered by the determined purpose and foreknowledge of God, you have taken by lawless hands, have crucified and put to death. Now that was a popular statement, wasn't it? He was being politically correct, wasn't he? My goodness. He was accusing them, this generation of Israel, of crucifying the Lord Jesus. Of course, as we know, Israel did not stand alone in that responsibility. But the whole world is guilty of the death of Jesus. You want to know who killed Jesus? Look in the mirror, and you'll see the one who killed Jesus. My sins killed Jesus. Your sins killed Jesus. But here, Peter is throwing the gauntlet down and saying that this generation of Israel has crucified and put Him to death. Verse 24, whom God raised up, having loosed the pains of death, because it was not possible. Possible that He should be held by it. Death did not hold Him. He was victorious over death. He conquered death. He rose from the dead. Now, how would you prove that from the Old Testament? That's the job Peter has now. Are you proficient in proving the resurrection of the Messiah from the Old Testament? Well, all you need to know is this passage that Peter presents now. But you better know it good. For David says concerning Him, I foresaw the Lord always before my face, for He is at my right hand, that I may not be shaken. Therefore my heart rejoiced, and my tongue was glad. Moreover, my flesh will also rest in hope, for You will not leave my soul in Hades, nor will You allow Your Holy One to see corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of joy in Your presence. What a prophecy. David is prophesying that his flesh will rest in hope when he dies. And then you begin to wonder, is he speaking about himself or another? And we see who he is speaking about. He's speaking about the Messiah. For You will not leave my soul in Hades. Well, that's true of all saints, of all believers. But the next statement is the one that separates from believers to the Messiah Himself. Nor will You allow Your Holy One to see corruption. Did his body see corruption?
Yes!
So He's not speaking of Himself. He's speaking of the Holy One. The Messiah would not see corruption. That means, when does the body begin to corrupt? And especially if you're not pumped up with formaldehyde. Very quickly. And by the end of 3 days, on the fourth day, what happens? By this time, it stinketh, as the Scripture says. So, Jesus, the Holy One, His body had to be raised from the dead before 4 days. that is on the third day. You have made me to know, known to me the ways of life. You have made me full of joy. You have made me full of joy in your presence. Men and brethren, let me speak freely to you. Now, coming a little closer, he says, I want to talk to you about this. I want to explain this passage to you. Let me speak freely to you of the patriarch David, that he is both dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. I want to show you some things. There's the tongues of flame coming down upon the disciples, and Peter preaching to the disciples. That's an Elamite who might have been in the crowd that day. But this is David's tomb, at least an artist's conception of David's tomb. This is a little better picture of it, I think. It was a big monument, and it was located in the environs of the upper room. That's another reason why I think this all happened in and around the upper room. And so you can imagine Peter pointing to David's tomb in the near area there and saying, "We know about David. There's his tomb right there. And he's dead and buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Therefore, being a prophet, and knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that of the fruit of his body, according to the flesh, he would raise up the Christ to sit on his throne, he, foreseeing this, spoke concerning the resurrection of the Christ, of the Messiah, that his soul was not left in Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption." He was not speaking of himself, but he was prophesying of his son, his greater son, the Messiah, who would not see corruption, but he would rise from the dead. Verse 32, "This Jesus God has raised up, of which we are all witnesses." We have seen him. Every one of these people here has seen him risen from the dead. This is no Bubamitzer. This is no grandmother's tale. This is no myth. This is reality. It has happened. "Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he poured out this which you now see and hear." Now this is speaking particularly of the man Christ Jesus. It was the man Christ Jesus who died. It was the man Christ Jesus who rose from the dead. It is the man Christ Jesus who has been exalted and elevated to the right hand of the throne of the majesty in the heavens. God the Son has always been with the Father throughout all eternity. But it was this new experience where God the Son took on human flesh and became a man. And he underwent all of these experiences. This is the God-man, Christ Jesus. Verse 34, "For David did not ascend into the heavens, but he himself says, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool.'" Psalm 110, the Father said to Jesus, "Sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool." He's still doing that. He hasn't come back yet, but one day he will. Verse 36, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ." Now that's quite a statement. you thought this guy was just a Galilean traveling rabbi, reformer, who made many boasts and so forth. And you thought he was a pretender, and you thought he was a fraud, and you thought he was an evildoer. In fact, some of you said that he was possessed of demons. Such is not the case. The Lord God has made him both Lord and Christ. You see, that passage back before, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand. Now this was David speaking. The Lord, Yahweh, said to my Lord, whoa, did David have two lords? Did David have anybody as Lord except God? Yes, he had God the Father and the Messiah. The Lord said to his Lord, to my Lord, David says, sit at my right hand. So, what are you going to do when you hear this? You're an Israelite who has heard all of this. And did we do that? Did we make a mistake? Were we wrong? Did we not know who this was? Now, when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Now they weren't laughing at them and saying, well, these are just a bunch of drunkards. Now they were saying, whoa, this man is preaching that we have done a terrible thing, that we have missed the Messiah, that we have been responsible for crucifying him, and that God has raised him from the dead, and he is really the Messiah. What are we going to do now? And many of them were pricked to the heart, cut to the heart. Well, that was showing that the Holy Spirit was doing his job of convicting, didn't he? It wasn't just Peter's words. It was the convicting power of the Holy Spirit. Then Peter said to them, repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. They were to repent. Repent, what does that mean? It means change your mind. You've been going in one direction, you need to turn around and go the other direction. You got to change your thinking, which is probably the hardest thing in the world for a person to do, to change his thinking. They call it an attitude adjustment, I think, today. But to change your mind about the things of God, to change your mind about Jesus, who he is and what he has done and what has occurred about his death and his resurrection. You've got to repent. You've got to change your mind. Be baptized as evidence of your repentance, of the evidence of your belief, of the evidence that you have trusted in Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. You're going to be forgiven. All that's happened before, you're forgiven. All your sins are forgiven. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Now you won't be trusting to your own power, to your own wisdom, to your own guidance. You will be trusting to the guidance and the blessing and the fullness of the Holy Spirit. Verse 39, for the promise is to you and to your children. Now, basically, he's still speaking to Israel here. And to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Now, we're going to see that what he is saying here, what he is giving Israel an opportunity of, is to receive the Lord nationally. Now, they had an opportunity to receive the Lord nationally while he was here. And especially when he came down the Mount of Olives on the donkey, and the remnant received him and welcomed him. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Welcome, King Jesus. And they received him. Yes.
Okay. From Dr. Brummett. What is the gift of the Holy Spirit? It is indwelling, baptism.
Well, it's good to hear from Dr. Brummett. Maybe he should be here to answer the question. We've appreciated his ministry among us. Well, I believe that when any person receives Christ, he receives the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes to indwell him forever. And that is an understanding of the gift of the Holy Spirit. For Israel, had Israel received the Lord nationally, there would have been this tremendous national conversion of the nation and the indwelling of the Spirit and all the promises pertaining to the kingdom. That did not happen, and so was not fulfilled. We're told also that the Holy Spirit baptizes those who believe into the body of Christ. And that occurs at belief. When we receive Jesus, one of the jobs of the Holy Spirit is to baptize us into the body of Christ. And I would look upon that as a great gift. There are some 30 or so operations that happen to an individual at the time of salvation, at the time of justification, at the time a person receives Christ. And in a sense, you could look upon every one of these as being a gift of the Holy Spirit. And this was really an offer to the nation Israel, as we'll see in the next few verses next week, to come to the Lord and to receive Him, and with the possibility that the Lord would return soon, very quickly. Jesus is at the right hand of God, as we see in Acts 2:35. And so, those are the main things about the first chapter of Acts. I would suggest on into the 40th verse of the second chapter. And this gets us off to a good start. Next week, we'll see the conclusion of Peter's message to Israel, an invitation for Israel to receive the Lord, and for the days of restoration to occur, as it were, soon, right away. It could have happened. It didn't. And so the stumbling of Israel has become a blessing to the Gentiles. So that now the gospel is going forth to the Gentiles, and the body of Christ is being formed throughout the world. But one day, and we're still part of that, and we're still involved in that, one day Israel is going to believe and be restored, and the Lord is going to return to this earth. We'll see about that next week. Okay, well, we're delighted to have here our good friend, Pastor Tom Pesnell. And if he would come forward and lead us in our benediction and any choice words that he might have for us tonight. Thank you so much. It's been great being with you this evening. I think we're off to a good start.
That's why we all came tonight, isn't it?
Amen.
I hear a wonderful presentation of the gospel, and it's so exciting to see how it all began, and what a thrill it is. And thank you, Tom, for the precious fruit of the Spirit in your life. We have several that we need to pray for. Debbie Clark, her cancer is back, and Debbie is the sister-in-law of Maxine Bradford's brother. Also, Sharon Saylor, she has cancer. Maxine, and that's Maxine Bradford's sister. Also, there's a man about 40-something years old that's in the hospital over in Medical Center, Mother Francis Hospital, that I'm in the process of trying to reach for Christ. And he is so down. He's really close to making a commitment to Christ, but Jess is not only unsaved, but he is in the throes of death. And I hope that you will, we'll need to pray for these as we offer our prayer to the Lord tonight. Heavenly Father, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for the history, things that happened in a real world, in a wonderful way where you intervened and did some marvelous things. God, it was a marvelous day in each of our lives when we came to Jesus, gave him our hearts and lives, admitted our sin and our failure, and Lord, trusted in the redemptive work of Jesus. And Lord, at that moment, the Holy Spirit invaded our hearts and captured us and gave us new life and hope. And as we are gathered here today, very expectant for the return of Christ, we just thank you, God, that the hope and the joy that's in our hearts tonight will be fulfilled soon as we wait for his coming. Thank you for the victories that you give us in Christ. And as we wait for that wonderful moment, help us, God, to sow and reap and to be faithful to you. In Jesus' name.